Today on Typical Books, we'll be talking about new books coming out, not only from Horror Writers Association authors, but all sorts. There's only about 8 books I want to highlight coming out in July. So yes, there's quite a few summary books here too. One that I am dying to read that I didn't realize is already out now. And also some books that are like controversial or very exciting. And those two things can exist in the same book, believe me. So yes, we have The Ones Who Come Back Hungry by Emmalinda Berube. I know it's already into the beginning of July, but we're going to go back to July 2nd. And this particular book has caught my eye, even though the cover, honestly, isn't very exciting. And in the description, you'll see why I'm so excited. The Let the Right One In meets Wilder Girls in a Bram Stoker-nominated horror novelist Emmalinda Berube's latest novel, an unsettling and atmospheric vampire story about a girl whose beloved sister comes back to life and the hunger that haunts them both. We just watched Handling the Undead, and having a Let the Right One In connotation here has me doubly excited. After the sudden death of her popular, athletic older sister, 16-year-old Jo fears her shattered family may never recover from the loss of their golden girl. But 3 days after crying at Audrey's graveside, Jo stumbles on the impossible. Audrey, standing barefoot in the backyard, real and solid with the quilt they buried her in wrapped around her shoulders. Except Audrey isn't breathing. She's still marred with evidence of an autopsy, and she's decaying rapidly, even in the winter freeze. And I'll leave the rest to your imagination or, you know, concrete analysis when you pick this book up, because despite the cover not being that enticing, we're in an age where covers change with the wind. So who knows, maybe we'll get a different edition. But yeah, Emmalinda Berube, not read anything by this author, so I'm very excited. The next book is Wilderness Reform by Matt and Harrison Query. And if that name, those names together, strike a familiar tone with you, you might remember I really liked, I think it was their debut novel, Old Country. Old Country was so cool, and whenever I see people talk about it, I get very excited, because some people found it really boring, some people didn't like the characters. I loved everything about that book. It was very for me. I even bought my sister a copy because it seemed to be the sort of book that we would write, you know? So yeah, Matt and Harrison Query now have Wilderness Reform, and the cover makes me think it's got something to do with Old Country, maybe. Mostly because it takes place in the wilderness, I suppose. Like, there's forest and there's a skull looming in the background, which is kind of eerie, and a little fire going on, and you know, it's got a very good color balance too, so it's just a cool cover. 13-year-old Ben is sent to a remote reform program for troubled teens by a juvenile court judge. But when he arrives at camp located at the edge of the vast wilderness in northwestern Montana, he immediately recognizes that there's something off about the counselors. Isn't there always something off about at least one counselor? They're too friendly and upbeat, yet Ben can tell there's an undercurrent of menace. As he gets to know the boys in his cabin, he soon discovers they each have far more going on with them than whatever crime landed them here. And each has a different critical skill, one that could help them unearth what is really going on in this place and how to make it out alive. They are inching ever closer to the truth, and the hidden evil beneath the camp surface will make itself known in order to deter them. It could have done without that last sentence, really. You know, we want to know, like, make it out alive. Dun dun dun, just leave it there, right? But I'm excited because I really, really enjoyed Old Country, and I think that this might have a more upbeat plot. The other one was really kind of a melancholy dirge of a story, but it's those scarecrows. When you read Old Country, you know what I mean? Those scarecrows just clinched it for me. It's forever an important book to me, so I'm very interested to read Wilderness Reform. The next book on the list, July 9th, is, it seems everyone's already read it, so I don't know if it already came out or something, but it says the hardcover coming out July 9th, Bury Your Gaze by Chuck Tingle. And I had just read an article about a lot of TV shows are killing off gay characters. I guess it's happened the past couple years, and like unceremoniously killing them off, which is mental. And now they're like hiding the gays, canceling the gays. The gays go on extended trips on the shows, and it's just weird, especially when so many shows that highlight LGBTQ+ people are like doing really well and really important and fun and cool and done right, but maybe it's the ones that aren't done right. Maybe it's the characters that were put in as a token character. I don't know, because I don't watch TV, so I'm not really sure what it is, but Barrier Gaze may be coming at the right point. Chuck Tingle. This is not his first foray into more mainstream horror, from what I understand. Misha knows that chasing success in Hollywood can be hell. But finally, after years of trying to make it, his big moment is here. An Oscar nomination, and the executives at the studio for his long-running streaming series know that just the thing to kick his career to the next level is kill off gay characters for the algorithm? What? What? Like, what? It's really actually happening. In the upcoming season finale, Misha refuses but soon realizes that he's put a huge target on his back, and what's worse, monsters from his horror movie days are stalking him and his friends through the hills above Los Angeles. Haunted by his past, Misha must risk his entire future before the horrors from the silver screen find a way to bury him for good. It's weird that this is actually happening in the journalism, in real life, in television, I suppose. I just read this article and I thought, wow, this really ties in. I thought Barrier Gaze was a fictional book, but apparently not. Very interesting. And after having just watched Maxine, Ty West's third in his trilogy, I don't know what the name of the trilogy is, but X and Pearl and Maxine are this trilogy film, if you are not aware. And it's really cool because it's like this sort of, I want to be a star in the Hollywood Hills kind of thing. So I think this ties into that sort of feel, that whole vibe. I don't know. This would take place in the Common Era, whereas Maxine takes place in the 80s. But yeah, very interesting and timely for whatever reason. I don't know why we have this fixation on Hollywood these days when we're doing, it seems, all that we can to push the Hollywood system and the big studio system away by embracing like indie movie, indie horror, indie everything, and like small Canadian films are like doing better than ever, it seems, because people want to see anything but Hollywood glitz and glam. Yet we are like exploiting it in a way and wanting like this sort of pseudo throwback 80s weird Hollywood American Psycho version of a big city. I don't know. I don't understand what's going on with that, let alone why they're killing off all the gay characters. Anyhow, on a lighter note, July 16th, we have I Was a Teenage Slasher by Stephen Graham Jones, 1989, talking about throwbacks. La Mesa, Texas, a small West Texas town driven by oil and cotton and a place where everyone knows everyone else's business. So it goes for a Tolly driver, a good kid with more potential than application, 17 and about to be cursed to kill for revenge. Here, Stephen Graham Jones explores the Texas he grew up in, which is very interesting, and the unfairness of being on the outside through the slasher horror that he lives, but from the perspective of the killer, Tolly, writing his own autobiography. Okay, that sounds, this could be fun. This is the kind of tone that Stephen Graham Jones works really well with. Find yourself rooting for a killer, I'm there, in this summer teen movie of a novel gone full blood-curdling tragic. Okay, very excited, because this is the sort of thing that Stephen Graham Jones is known for. I think fans of his will really like it. And it's also, he's writing in the key he sings best in. So I think that those who are middling or on the fence may come around. That's what I'm just hoping anyway. I will say though that the cover, like the first book I talked about, is not very interesting, and I don't know what it is. Very rarely does a Stephen Graham Jones book have a good cover, and I don't understand why. He's a fantastic, thoughtful guy. I don't know if he leaves it in the hands of other people to decide. The Only Good Indians had a beautiful cover everyone loved. I love that cover. And you know, this one is just weird. It's just weird. But it does go with another book of his. I can't remember right now. But this book, The Deading, by Nicholas Belardis, whose name I'm not sure I'm pronouncing properly. The Deading has a beautiful cover of a bird attacking another bird mid-flight, and not just attacking, its guts are strewn about the sky and its wings are about to fall to earth. It's great. And the typography is amazing. I like this almost throwback to 80s custom typographical features with a very cool gothic type serif font. It's neat. It's a very neat looking cover. So yeah, like a copper plate, not a gothic, more like a copper plate text going on. But yeah, there's me nerding out on typography, but the deading, yeah, really cool looking cover. And we get a lot of small towns. I don't know what it is about summer horror and small towns, even if it's not specifically a summer horror. In a small fishing town known for its aging birding community and the local oyster farm, a hidden evil emerges from the depths of the ocean. It begins with sea snails washing ashore, attacking whatever they cling to. This mysterious infection starts transforming the wildlife, the seascapes, and finally the people. And I've got to say, if you like this description so far, check out Tide Pool by Nicole Wilson. It's like my favorite book for the past couple years. I'll keep recommending it. Once infected, residents of Baywood start deading, collapsing and dying, only to rise again, changing in ways both fanatical and physical. As the government cuts the town off from the rest of the world, the uninfected, including the introverted bird-loving Blaze and his jaded older brother Chongo, realize their town could be ground zero for a fundamental shift in all living things. Soon, disturbing beliefs and autocratic rituals emerge, overseen by the death-worshipping risers, people who must choose how to survive, how to find home, and whether or not to betray those closest to them. So yes, I like this. I don't like when a post-apocalyptic type book, and what there's others in here, I think, they make up words or choose words and change words in a cultish way to describe what's going on in the world. And it's every zombie book does it. This one isn't so bad. You know, I think I can grow to like Deaders and Risers, but the deading, yeah, a very amazing looking cover. I'm very excited to read this like post-apocalyptic on the seashore kind of thing. I think that's something that hasn't really been done. And I've been playing a lot of D4, Diablo 4, and the coastline areas with all of the merman and things like that is my favorite place to go. And there's not really a storyline as much about these like weird Innsmouthian places that are there. There's very few side quests that go there, and I just wish I could go there all the time. Three more books to go. On July 23rd, we have The Drowning House by Cherry Priest. I've not read any other Cherry Priest, I don't think. I believe they write more thriller stuff, but correct me if I'm wrong. I think I like this the most because there is a house on the cover of the book. A violent storm washes a mysterious house onto a rural Pacific Northwest beach, stopping the heart of the only woman who knows what it means. Her grandson, Simon Culpepper, vanishes in the aftermath, leaving two of his childhood friends to comb the small, isolated island for answers. But decades have passed since Melissa and Leo were close, if they were ever close at all. Now they'll have to put aside old rivalries and grudges if they want to find or save the man who brought them together in the first place, and on the way they'll learn a great deal about the sinister house on the beach, the man who built it, and the evil he's bringing back to Marrowstone Island. Okay, well, yeah, Simon Culpepper, Marrowstone Island, they're really good at naming things. And a house that suddenly appears isn't as unique in horror fiction as you may think. I've been using 666 as a mouse pad for the duration of this program, and it is about that exact same thing. A house that mysteriously appears across the road by supernatural forces. This one gets washed ashore, so that's really cool. And more seaside horror. On July 30th, we leave the seaside, we leave the slashers maybe, for Ghost Camera by Darcy Coates. I love the cover of this book. And it doesn't, you know, Darcy Coates' books have some very different covers. A lot of them feature a house on the front because there's a lot of haunted house books in her repertoire. Thank God for that. And that's why she has such a big fan base, I believe. But the books that aren't about haunted houses and some of the series that she's been writing, very different stuff. The cover of this reminds me a lot of Hunted, I believe the book is, where it's just a very different book that Darcy Coates was writing. And I like this, that it's got some very blood red things dripping down the front and just looks like a serial killer photo album. And I am very excited to check this out at the end of the month. There's too many books coming out. I might have to do a poll on Patreon or here on YouTube to try and sort out what book I'm going to read, aside from the Matt and Harrison Query book. When Janine finds an abandoned Polaroid camera, she playfully snaps a photo without a second thought, like you do. But there's something wrong with the image. A ghostly figure stands in the background watching her, fixated on her. moving one step closer with every picture she takes. Not unlike a Stephen King story about a dog that does the same thing. Desperate, Janine shares her secret with her best friend, Bree, and together they realize the camera captures more unsettling impressions of the dead. But now the ghosts seem to be following the two friends, and with each new photo taken, a terrible danger grows ever nearer. Okay, this is a re-release with other short stories in amongst it. So if you've really liked her small horrors book and her short stories in general, or the small novellas that are sometimes included at the end of other books by her, then you'll probably really enjoy this. I know I will. I haven't read it yet, so I'm very excited. Also out the same day on July 30th is another book I really want to buy. So this makes it really tough this month to decide what to get. Heads Will Roll by Josh Winning. It seems to be a quintessential summer horror fiction book, and the cover is amazing. If you dig groovy covers like you know I do, then this one is up there. This one, along with The Deading, are my two favorite covers coming out in July. Black background, two sticks with roasted marshmallows coming down from the top, and a bloody axe, dripping blood, literally freshly dripping blood, that are roasting over what appears to be flames at first, but is just a red-tinted pine border. So it's just a really cool photographic trick. Decent, you know, marker-style text on the front in the words, heads will roll, that also have blood dripping on them from that axe. It's just all comes together into a really cool summer camp slasher one sheet. I just love the idea of this, and I don't know what it's about yet. I've been seeing this cover for a while. This cover came up in new releases a while ago. I've seen this cover on Edelweiss, looking at new releases coming up there. I haven't even read the summary because I don't care what it's about. I'm going to buy it and I want to read it because I'm basing all of that love already on the cover alone. After sitcom star Willow tweeted herself into infamy and stumbled blind drunk into a swimming pool, her agent shipped her off to Camp Castaway. Tucked away in upstate New York, Castaway is a summer camp for adults who are desperate to leave their mistakes behind. No real names, no phones, and no way to call for help. Now that sounds like it is a culmination of all the cool things in a lot of the books we just talked about. We have Hollywood eating itself by its tail. We have camp slashers. We have, you know, out of control psychopaths, and we have a summertime setting, upstate New York, no less, not too far from me, where there is an old camp that is a castaway sort of camp for reformation. And this is not the first reformation story coming out in July. So that's just a really cool trend. I like this idea of people being sent away into the forest, out of their control, which seems to be a trend coming out of the pandemic where we were all stuck in our houses beyond our control. So yeah, this reminds me quite a lot of Con Season by Adam Caesar, one of my favorite Adam Caesar books. And if you're interested in that sort of like camp slasher gone awry with adults, then this might be the book for you. Have any of these books already landed on your reading list, or have I enticed you into reading a book or two here? Because I know I'm interested in reading them all, which is tough because there's only so much time. Or have you already read some of these? Let me know in the comments below. Thank you very much for watching, and have an ooky, spooky day.